Welcome, listener. My name is Kai. I will guide you on your journey home. Adjust your auditory settings and open your mind to Homecoming, written by Sheila Finch, performed by Martin Jarvis. This story is brought to you in partnership with XPRIZE. Prepare yourself. The future has arrived. At 4:58 a.m. on June 28, 2020, the passengers on board ANA Flight 008, en route from Tokyo to San Francisco, are cruising at an altitude of 37,000 feet, approximately 1,500 nautical miles off the west coast of the United States. A small bump, otherwise noted as a barely perceptible bout of turbulence, passes Flight 008 through a temporary wrinkle in the local region of space-time. What these passengers will soon find out as they descend into SFO is that the wrinkle has transported them 20 years into the future, and the year is now 2040. This is the story of the passenger in seat 29F.
Too late now to decide she was doing the wrong thing. Going home after that stormy family scene 4 years ago, full of anger and despair, that had propelled her to take a job in Tokyo, was probably an invitation for personal disaster. There'd been no communication between Kate and her mother since. Whatever reception she faced at home, it wouldn't be the welcome she'd come to realize she needed to heal the past. The ANA flight attendant checked she had her seatbelt on for landing, tray in the upright position. Other passengers stretched, yawned, got things out of the overhead bins, put things away. Kate had only a very small travel bag under the seat in front of her. They were low now, coming in over the crowded East Bay. It looked different from this height. More built up, but at the same time greener. She didn't remember so many high-rises, windows flashing in the sun. Places, even familiar ones, looked different when you saw them from the sky. Wheels contacted the ground. The engines roared in reverse. Nervousness brought sweat out on her forehead. Going home was a dumb idea. What she'd done was unforgivable. That furious fight on the last day, blaming her mother, as if she'd been the one to give birth to him. Her mouth suddenly too dry to form the name the social worker wrote on the birth certificate. Stupid. Probably hadn't even lived. Deformed and bawling like a sick cat. 12 months if he's lucky, the Stanford University neonatal specialist said. She hadn't wanted a child in the first place. 19. She'd just begun to get her life together. One stupid mistake. She'd run all the way to Japan, and in 4 years she'd turned her life around, even managing to invest a little.
Welcome to San Francisco,
an attendant's voice said brightly.
Local time is 10:41. Temperature...
The voice cut off suddenly. Kate stood up, waited in the slow-moving line. Seemed like an argument up ahead, something not right. She recognized the businessman from a couple of rows ahead, the one who'd had too much to drink even before he'd boarded. She knew his obnoxious type. He was waving his arms, denying something the flight attendant had just said. Other passengers joined the argument. Voices rose. Seizing her chance, she ducked under the man's arm. The tunnel was bright and smooth, seamless. Reaching the gate, she searched for the sign for global entry passengers. There seemed to be a commotion at one end of the immigration hall. Everybody collecting around someone, desks unattended, a PA system blaring. Maybe somebody had died. She strolled through an unattended aisle and found herself in the ticketing area. The hall had undergone considerable renovation. The windows seemed larger, the flooring gentler on her feet. The music had lost the tinny edge she remembered. Same lines of people, though, getting and changing tickets. She pulled her cell out to call Uber. The website wasn't working. Damn! It hadn't occurred to her there might be upgrades in the 4 years she'd been gone, hers now incompatible. Now what? Would there be a taxi stand outside? Her eye caught on a wall listing of hotels and local attractions. A row of buttons. Under transportation, she found Uber and pressed it. Entered her mother's address just north of the zoo on the Pacific side of the peninsula. She could only hope her mother hadn't moved. They'd had no contact. Her choice. 10 seconds later, one of the carts that transported people and their bags around the airport slid up beside her. There was no driver.
Please put your luggage on the floor and take a seat.
No one was nearby. Then she saw the small sign on the front, the umlauted U.
Please take a seat.
Feeling like Alice in Wonderland, she did as she was told. The cart rolled smoothly forward, heading for a brightly lit tunnel. She remembered a brief train ride from the terminal at SFO to the car rental desks and the parking facility. This was another upgrade. It felt strange to have no porter driving, but seemed safe enough in the tunnel. The blonde behind the counter, under a twinkling Uber logo, stared intently at a data screen. She had long emerald green fingernails and green lipstick. San Francisco always tilted to the weird side. Too much hot music, too many hot drugs. That was how she'd messed up in the first place. Ended up having him.
Will you be wanting automated or driver? Driver is more expensive,
the girl said. She had the most stunning set of gleaming white teeth Kate had ever seen, and that was even being used to the cosmetic perfections women sought in Tokyo these days.
Excuse me? Automated takes you through the musk tunnels, you know, fast but boring. Tourists usually go for a driver. I'm sorry, but I don't really understand any of that.
The girl flicked back a stray blonde lock, revealing deep purple undertones, leaned over the counter and peered at her.
Oh, you one of them?
The emphasis she gave the word made it sound like Kate had just climbed out of the Black Lagoon.
I just want to get a ride out to... How'd you get through security? We got a news pop 2 minutes ago. They said they'd be holding all the passengers from your flight for orientation. Must be a terrible shock.
Look, I live here. Or I used to. I've been away for 4 years.
Wow! Then you don't know anything, do you? They said the ANA plane that just landed from Tokyo was from 2020.
Her eyes, emerald-lidded like her lips and nails, were wide with wonder.
Yes, 2020.
Anything wrong with that?
The girl's expression shut down.
I'm not authorized to offer explanations. Ask the onboard AI. They don't always worry about regulations.
She bent over a small keypad.
This the right address you entered when you called us?
Milagro Drive, yes.
Kate nodded.
Do you take Amex? No prob. That address is registered with Unibank. We'll bill it.
She wondered uneasily what her mother would think about that. None of this was making sense. Unreal, like a hallucination. A door slid open behind the counter, revealing what looked like an iridescent bubble outside in brilliant sunshine. Cinderella's carriage. No taxi of any kind looked like that when she left. No taxi in Innovation Mad Tokyo either. And no driver. The industrial buildings across the street looked new, painted bright, neon colors. The smooth roadway was lined with tall trees heavy with pink and white blossoms, more like the Caribbean, where her boss had sent her last year on business, than San Francisco. In the distance, she caught a sparkle from the bay. The bubble's doors lifted like wings, inviting her in.
Welcome,
a voice said. Strangely British, she thought, unlike the obviously machine-generated one of the baggage cart.
Please make yourself comfortable.
The stress was getting to her.
I don't feel comfortable talking to a disembodied voice.
I'm a limited duty AI. No need for a physical presence. This will be a short trip. I'll try to make it a pleasant one. If you need a beverage, just look.
I need answers.
The bubble car moved forward so smoothly it was hard to believe it made contact with the road. Silent. Some kind of maglev technology.
Ah. You must have evaded the welcoming committee, who would have explained everything.
This isn't San Francisco, is it? At least, not as I remember it.
I would think not. We've made a lot of progress since then.
And this isn't 2020 either, although I have no idea what that means.
No, it isn't.
The AI sounded apologetic.
It's 2040.
Not possible. It was June 2020 when I boarded the plane.
It's June, certainly, but you've jumped 20 years.
Either she was dreaming or she was going crazy. What her mother had warned when she was doing so many drugs before him. But she hadn't touched anything since. If she could have gone back and lived those years over, she would have done things differently. Something she needed to make her mother understand. The past couldn't be undone, but understanding was a step toward healing. But 20 years later?
It must be quite a shock, having your plane make a jump like that. They were going to try and break it gently to the passengers. They didn't want to induce trauma. How did you slip through?
Doesn't matter. Tell me how this happened.
Are you trained in the sciences by any chance?
I was a business major at Stanford.
She didn't feel a need to add she'd had to drop out after a year because of him.
Oh, fine choice of school. I'll use layman's terms. There's been some kind of... Were you familiar with the Star Wars series in your time? Yes? Then think of it as being a kind of disturbance in the Force. A break in the continuum of time. Somehow your plane just slipped. Jumped, actually. We aren't totally sure just yet.
This made no sense. Are you saying I'm stuck here now in 2040?
I'm afraid so. We don't see any way to send you back. But I'm sure you'll like it. There have been so many advances since your time. Engineering advances, medical discoveries, agricultural miracles, revolutions in architecture and entertainment, advances in space travel. Take a little time. Consider taking a tour of near-Earth space. Try zero-G poker.
You're not telling me you have Las Vegas in space?
Technically, it's a collaboration between Google and Virgin Galactic, using a BISI, a Bigelow Inflatable Space Installation. And the view's quite spectacular.
She closed her eyes against this catalogue of the brave new world.
Oh, my God.
Not at all,
the AI said primly.
Sheer human ingenuity. Aided by our intelligence, of course, once we came online.
The bubble moved smoothly along.
Wouldn't you like to look at the scenery?
The AI asked gently.
We're approaching Skyline Boulevard.
Why not? She was going to be spending the rest of her life here.
You'll be happy to know we've solved pollution problems. Clean energy breakthroughs have taken care of our air and water.
The seamless glass bubble allowed her an almost 360-degree view of shimmering towers, delicate spires, apartment buildings like palaces on all sides, many sparkling lakes where only Lake Merced had been before, thick with multicolored sails, children wading along the banks. She saw roads, but very little traffic on them.
The Musk tunnels. They've eliminated urban congestion.
One tall, impressive building that combined the features of a modern skyscraper with the slim buttresses and lacy bridges of a Disney confection drew her attention. She pointed to it.
The new San Francisco campus of Stanford University's medical school. Most prestigious medical school in the world. Home of the most revolutionary procedures in both ends of life. Pediatric care and life extension. But we're almost there.
The bubble slowed to a walking pace. A little boy waved from a jungle gym in a park. The gym, sensing the child's inattention, changed its configuration, and he began exploring again.
Simple task to make the playground equipment responsive to a child's interests. You had the start of it at amusement parks like Disneyland and Harry Potter World.
She had a hard time recognizing Milagro Drive. Trees that had been freshly planted when her mother had first moved in were now tall and flowering, and the houses looked polished, bright paint and sparkling glass.
Self-cleaning paint.
Are you reading my mind?
Of course not. I'm programmed to follow your eye movement and use an algorithm to predict what you're interested in. You might have noticed the beginnings of this system if you spent any time online in 2020.
Immaculate lawns. Evidently, water shortages were a thing of the past. What would it be like to live here? No wood about it. This was going to be home from now on. She couldn't go back to Japan. Someone else would have her job by now. A gardener tended rose bushes, shears in one hand, as the bubble came to a stop before her mother's house. The scent of the blooms was almost overpowering. Tall, mid-twenties, as far as she could see under the wide-brimmed straw hat. Muscular, the type she'd been attracted to in her misspent youth. A wheelbarrow with no discernible wheels followed him as he worked. He didn't look up as the bubble settled on the grass. Kate got out slowly, suddenly hesitant. What was she going to say? Would her mother welcome her or slam the door? Would she even believe she was a time traveler? She dropped her small bag on the step, reached for the doorbell, and found it not there. Instead, there was a small pad for a thumbprint. Naturally, it wouldn't read hers. How did visitors announce their presence? The door opened. Woman in her 60s, wiping flour-covered hands on an apron. Dark hair now showing some grey, but otherwise looking fit. For a moment she thought her mother had moved away. This was a stranger. But the woman spoke, and she knew the voice instantly.
May I help you?
Her mother, always so proper.
Mom, it's Kate.
I don't know anybody by that name.
Your daughter. I've come from Tokyo.
And 2020, but that was best left unsaid for the moment.
To see you.
My daughter Kate would be a lot older than you.
The door began to close. Kate put a hand on the door.
Mom, I was coming home anyway, but my plane jumped 20 years.
I don't read trash like the International Enquirer.
No, it's true. It happened to my plane.
The woman stared at her, reading the truth in her features.
Katie? I meant to come home sooner, Mom.
Disbelief gave way to a kind of joy in her mother's face, swiftly followed by anger.
24 years it's been since you walked out. You'd be in your 40s if...
She broke off, tangled up by the break in time as much as her daughter. Kate sighed.
You have to believe me. Give me a chance. I was a stupid kid.
Walked out and left me with all the problems. I'm really sorry.
Her mother closed her mouth abruptly on whatever she'd been about to say.
You better come inside.
There was tea in a flowered Royal Doulton pot. Two cups on the table and chocolate cookies. Some things didn't change, thank goodness. Kate tried to explain how it had been at 19 facing catastrophe, how she'd clawed her way back to a life in Tokyo.
But Japan?
Her mother said.
My major professor at Stanford, his brother in Tokyo.
They were silent, sipping tea.
Can you forgive me, Mum?
Not a matter of me forgiving.
The front door opened, and the gardener came into the kitchen. Her mother fetched another cup and poured tea for him. Nobody said anything. Did gardeners always get tea after gardening in this new world? He was very good-looking without the old straw hat. She felt his eyes on her, appraising.
This is Michael,
her mother said.
And you're Kate,
he said, stretching long legs under the table.
There's a photo of you upstairs in your old bedroom.
Her cheeks flamed. How could this man know her bedroom?
Not a hollow, unfortunately, but good enough to recognize you.
He glanced across the teacups at her mother.
There was a news pop a few minutes ago about the plane from 2020. I'm guessing that explains a lot.
Kate stared at him. Something familiar about the dark eyes, the line of the sunburned cheekbones. She'd known a student like him at Stanford. She did the math. No, he had died a long time ago. The doctors had all agreed. That undeveloped set of lungs, those twisted limbs. 12 months they'd given him. And he was her age now.
Wonderful what they can do these days,
her mother said.
Stanford is a marvelous place for birth defects. But it took years and years.
Michael leaned across the table and took her hand in his. She felt the hot tears start.
Welcome home, Mum. We have a lot to talk about. 20 years.
She shook her head. He grinned.
If you'd invested in the stock market, you could be a billionaire by now.
Seeing her reaction, he added,
We'll look into it tomorrow.
Give her a few days to catch up. Maybe you should take her out to the Google Mirage.
Michael smiled.
Great idea. Zero-G swim bubble up there. Unless you prefer the casino.
Unreal. But it was going to be her reality from now on. Relief made her laugh.
Why not? I feel as if I've already hit the jackpot.
Time may bring us together. Time may force us apart. But here and now, we are together. Continue to listen, and I will show you how. That was Homecoming by Sheila Finch, performed by Martin Jarvis. This episode was directed and produced by Mark Holden, edited by Seth Olansky, and designed by Neil Wogenson and Seth Olansky at the Invisible Studios. Season 2 of Dust is brought to you in partnership with XPRIZE, designing and operating multi-million-dollar global competitions to accelerate the development of technological breakthroughs that benefit humanity. And ANA, All Nippon Airways. Flight 008 is co-produced with Eric Desatnik. Dust is produced by Stephen Michael and Margaret Laney at Gunpowder and Sky. Subscribe to Dust for new sci-fi every week.